So a few years ago, this physician in Orange County developed this drug, this chemical called Varroxan, and when that was administering it to people, and a few people died after injection. So the family is starting, you know, sued the physician. He was arrested, and he was stripped from his license, and now he's somewhere either in Mexico or Kenya, one of the two, trying to push his thing. Still.
Oh.
But that was a case, and also a physician in the valley that was just administering it. I mean, some of his patients wanted the drug, so he got it from the guy in Orange County and administered it in his office. Also got his license removed for that, because it was really you know, from off the left field, really strange.
What did it do? What did this drug do? I mean,
it's. It was supposed to destroy the virus in the blood. However, there was no, you know, no data behind it. It was just cooked on the kitchen counter and then administered to people.
Wow. Now, have you dealt with oxygen or ozone treatment?
I have a few clients here that went through that a few years ago. And ozone, I mean, oxygen therapies are a little different because you can do oxygen therapy through different ways. And right now there's a lot of interest in trying to increase the amount of oxygen in the blood of people to try to help them fight the disease and other infections. And they use hyperbaric chambers that are the chambers used for people who have the bands, where you can have people breathe a mixture which is rich in oxygen to bring more oxygen into their blood. Ozone is a whole different ballpark. My clients that were trying ozone had a lot of side effects, there was a lot of toxicity. They stopped doing it and they didn't see any effect. There was a study in Canada of ozone, they didn't see any effect either. But it's still going on after years and years and years. There are still people promoting ozone. And recently I have a client of mine who went to Las Vegas to receive an ozone treatment that was like $24,000. And he died during treatment. And he hid his body for a few days because he didn't know what to do with it. And so his lover was running all over Las Vegas trying to find him when his body was hidden by these guys and they have disappeared. We don't know where they are at this point. So the whole ozone thing is extremely, extremely suspicious. A lot of people are making a lot of money out of it. They are selling, you know, even powders that you can take, supposedly bring ozone in your body and things like that. And it's really, I mean, in my eyes, it's really bogus. The oxygen thing, on the opposite, has some potential for people who are really sick. It doesn't stop anything, but it seems to help their, relieve their symptoms and improve their quality of life, which is very important.
Now, so ozone, you said it was toxic?
Yeah,
I mean, was there some toxicity?
Well, the guy died. I mean, I guess it was toxic.
Well, isn't it? I mean, well, it's because what they probably gave him the wrong mixture. I mean, did they overload the system with the ozone and it caused a reaction that way?
I couldn't get to know exactly how they administer the ozone, but
it has to be medically.
Usually, yeah. Usually, what they do, they pull the blood out of the body, mix it with ozone, and push it back in the body. And if you're not professional to do that, you can't really have the blood, you know, coagulate more or less in the chamber and back in the body. You inject, you know, poison basically. And I don't know what happened in that particular case, but that's what people used to do, and it's really toxic. I mean, you have to understand that there's a whole. You know, people are really looking into what destroys the immune system in HIV disease. And one of the things we found out is that, you know, we produce some chemicals during normal biochemical reactions called free radicals. Okay? Also, exposure to pollutions and food preservative and smoking and things like that brings a lot of these free radicals. Free radicals are like bleaches. They bleach whatever they encounter, they destroy it. So we have in our body a lot of substances to fight the free radicals that are called antioxidant, and you know them, vitamin C, vitamin E, vitamin A, zinc, selenium, a bunch of them, okay? Well, people with HIV have very low level of antioxidants, so they are very, very vulnerable to free radicals. That's why we're trying to give more vitamin C, more vitamin E, and there's research being done about that, and it has been shown that when you increase the level of antioxidant, you slow down the virus. Now, These people with ozone, what they inject is an oxidizer. It's one more free radical in the body. And these people are not ready to withstand more free radicals. Their natural buffering system is down. So that's probably why where the toxicity is coming from.
Now, you said, oxygen, you felt was...
Oxygen has some potential to help the quality of life of people.
Now, is the hyperbaric chamber the way that you feel is the best way, or... Is there other methods?
It's an expensive one. I mean, there's many different ways to do that. You can just use an oxygen mask. The hyperbaric chamber is a little better. It brings oxygen really all over the body. We don't know at this point what the best way is. Maybe just, breathing, hyperventilating consciously for 10 minutes will do the job. I don't know. But hopefully we'll know soon.
What about aloe vera?
Oh gosh, aloe vera, it's a long story because there's this drug company in Texas that has...
Hang on, you're covering the microphone.
No, is it here?
No, it's there, it's
this drug company in Texas found out that it's a bunch of chemicals, one extract of aloe vera can block HIV and stimulate the immune system. And they have that approved not for humans but for cats that are that have FIV, which is the equivalent of HIV in cats. And it's approved, it's a drug approved for that. And so they are doing studies right now to see whether they can do, use that in people. And recently a short study has shown that people seem to benefit from the extract of aloe vera. So hopefully they're going to do a larger study, and if it works, well, the thing will be approved.
Now, just for the record, it's not like a typical aloe vera you buy in this...
No, it's not. I mean, I do not advise to put the old aloe vera plant in the blender and try an aloe shake because you would get diarrhea.
Even more simpler, it's not the kind that you would...
It's the same plant. However, the principle of extracting it is what is different, yeah.
But, I mean, you don't spray it on... You actually take it...
No, you take... They are tablets that they have and they use.
You take it internally.
Yeah. And also, I want to stress that the big bottle of aloe vera juice that you find in the stores have, 5% aloe vera and 95% water, even if they claim to be pure, okay?
Yeah.
I just want to stress that.
That seems to be a big problem with the aloe vera, that there's so many con artists out there.
Yeah.
The legality on that is still, I guess, is still out, right?
You can get aloe vera all over the place. I mean, you can even get concentrate, which has, the active principle in there with no problem. They don't claim to cure HIV. The FDA is really, really strict on whether what you claim. It's really a question of claim. If you claim this may help you to relieve your symptoms, and it's not toxic, they will look the other way. If you claim, I can cure AIDS in 2 hours and 15 minutes, then they will start, cracking right. down.
What kind of, what do you see as far as the future in treatments? Are there any new drugs that are being...
There's a lot of new drugs. There's a lot of new drugs that are coming up, especially new families of drugs, because so far we have only had the AZT family, and they're all, limited. Now there's drugs called TAT inhibitors, there are drugs called protease inhibitors. There's even a hint of gene therapy, where what you do is that you really build in the cells a mechanism to kill HIV and even prevent infection. Okay, these are all very experimental things, but they in the test tube they work rather well. So
gene therapy.
Yeah, what they do basically is that they infect every cell that could be infected by HIV with a special little device that stays in the cells and order the cells to destroy any HIV that could come.
Now this works in the test tube already.
Yeah, and that, in my opinion, that's where the solution is going to be. It's because it's at the same time a treatment and a vaccine in a way. because if you inject this little thing in people who are not yet infected, when HIV, if they get infected with HIV, HIV will be destroyed immediately.
Right.
Okay.
It will become hopefully like polio vaccine.
Yeah. Yeah. Although in completely different manner, I mean, it's different route, yeah. But the bottom line is the same. Yeah.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Now, yeah. Have you seen an increase in infection here at APLA? Have you seen a steady market increase in the number of people that came to be calling up?
Unfortunately, there's still more and more people getting infected as we speak. I mean, not just getting sick, but getting infected. And especially in populations that are not very well educated or have other concerns than HIV. Meaning, if you're a poor, drug-addicted black male in South Central, HIV is low on your list of priority, and using a condom is not exactly what you really care about. And that's where the bulk of the infection is right now. It's in poor, you know, low-income people, drug addicts, and people who don't care about it because they have other things to care. You know, homeless people.
Is it mostly young people, say early 20s, that tend to be? What is the highest rising group of HIV?
The problem is that we don't know. We know people are getting infected, but we don't. I mean, you cannot test everyone, so you cannot really quantify who's getting more infected. What we can quantify is who's getting more sick at this point. So we have a picture that is lagging a little bit behind what's happening. You know, so what I can tell you is that right now the two group at risk are women and teenagers.
Teenagers.
You know, when you're a teenager, you'll never die. I mean, you'll never get sick. You don't care. You know. Live forever. And that's really they know about AIDS. I mean, most of them know about AIDS. They know how to protect themselves. Why they are not doing it is because they have this feeling of, you know, I'll never die. And this is a big problem. And women, because they don't know they are at risk. And also because, I mean, the main way to protect against infection is a condom. And as far as I know, you don't put a condom on a woman, you put a condom on a man. So they have a little control over whether they're going to use a condom or not. They can try.
Is there such thing as I've heard of a female?
Yeah, it's been approved by the FDA last week. There's a female condom. However, it's better, but there's still men that don't want their partner to wear anything, or you know, they just want it in the raw.
And yeah, I would imagine that would take a while to be accepted too.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit what the definition of parallel track mechanism?
That's what I called expanded access program. It was called parallel track at the beginning. Now it's called expanded access program. It's just a semantic.
Oh, I see.
But that's what drug companies do to provide drugs before approval.
Now, I don't think we talked about DTC, did we? DTC?
DTC.
Is that?
Oh, gosh, DTC. Oh, my God, that's long. Oh, that's... I forgot about it. So DTC was this French drug, also known as Immuthiol, that was supposed to help the immune system by being an antioxidant, by fighting free radicals. And it was very popular. It was approved in New Zealand for people with AIDS. It was the first country to approve it. And then they did this large study in France, and they found out that people taking Immuthiol, or DTC, were doing more poorly than people not taking it. So they canceled the whole thing.
And that was history for, I see.
There are still physicians in this country that believe that there's some potential and still use it on their patient.
What kind of effects did it have?
It didn't have much. It would just kind of reduce toxicity, basically. I mean, supposedly people would keep their T cells. I mean, personally, I think for the same effect, if you use vitamin C or vitamin E, you probably get about the same effect, yeah.
What about DHPG?
Oh, DHPG is just another name for something called ganciclovir, which is a drug used against CMV, cytomegalovirus retinitis, which has been approved and has been used for years now.
And is it just not that effective, really?
CMV is a big problem because usually DHPG works at the beginning, then it doesn't work anymore, then they switch to a drug called foscarnet, and fosconate is very toxic. They have kidney toxicity, then they cannot use it anymore, and then we have nothing. And that's why CMV infection is really one of the main killers now, because we have nothing against
it. Is that right?
I mean, we have two drugs, but they quickly become unusable.
So what are the two main, so that is the main infection as far as age-related diseases?
In people who are under good care, meaning we have a physician that is taking care of them well, that's a lot of people die of CMV or die of what's called MAI, for Mycobacterium avium, which is Mycobacterium. It's a family of TB. It's not like TB, but the same family of germs, and it's a chronic infection that produces weight loss, fatigue, diarrhea, things like that. And although we have antibiotics against that, for people who have very low T cells, it gets, they have trouble controlling it.
Is CMV similar to that?
CMV is a disease mainly of the eye or the intestine, the lung a little bit, and they die of basically generalized infection with CMV. But that's for people who have a good doctor, because a lot of people just don't receive the care and they die of the main killer, what used to be the main killer, which is PCP, the pneumocystis pneumonia. But now PCP can be really well controlled, but you have to access healthcare to control it, okay? So for people who are in good care, PCP is not a problem. For people who are not in good care, PCP is still the main killer.
I see. What about AL-721?
Oh my God, AL-721, that was a long time ago. AL-721 was one of the first underground drugs for HIV. And I mean first, it was like 83. And it was a mixture of lipids extracted from egg yolk. And supposedly when you are taking that these lipids would go into the virus membrane and change its shape and make it unable to infect the cell. And it was this gooey, dark paste that tasted like rotten eggs that people would put on toast and eat. And it was mainly developed in Israel, and supposedly they had great results in Israel, but nothing really came out of it, and it disappeared.
It just didn't really do that much, and it wasn't that effective.
No. Oh gosh, that was disgusting.
Are you familiar with passive immune therapy?
Yeah, and it's very hot right now. Because, in passive immune therapy, what they do, they take the plasma of people who are seropositive but healthy and give that to people who are sick, hoping that in the plasma of people who are healthy, there's all the good things that can help people who are sick. Okay. So they did a large study here in L.A. where they were harvesting plasma and giving it to people, and they just released the results of the study. According to the drug company that did the study, it's wonderful, their T cells gone up, according to people who really analyzed the data, it's not that nice a picture, and even there's maybe no effect at all. I mean, right now there's a big controversy because they have not reported the entire data. Some things are missing, and if one of these missing things happened to be a failure of treatment, then the whole thing is gone. I mean, there's no significance at all. So recently in AIDS Treatment News, which is one of the newsletters we read, there's this very good article about passive immune therapy showing that at this point, there's no evidence that it's helping at all. And not only that, but there's a French study that has shown that when people receive that and stop receiving it, they get sick really quickly, probably because their immune system gets, because they are given all this immune stuff, the immune system say, okay, fine, I have no work to do, and goes to sleep. And when you stop it, it takes time for the immune system to kick in again. But in the meantime, infections can come be a problem.
That's interesting, because we were talking with Richard Ross about it.
Mm-hmm.
And they were excited about it, but I guess the studies just haven't really been done clearly enough to show that it's
mm-hmm.
very positive.
And the big study has shown absolutely, very little effect. Some people have symptoms clearing, they have little minor things that get better. But in terms of survival, keeping the T cells, things like that.
Is a drug company behind that, though? Because there really isn't a drug involved.
No, there's it's not a drug, but there's a company, a blood products company called Hemacare, that is behind it, that is paying for everything. Yeah.
We've heard that. Yeah. That name.
Yeah. So a lot of physicians are making a mint with this thing,
right,
because they tell people to give their plasma, and people out of their good heart to give their plasma, and then they sell that for, you know, $500 a pop, and they make a fortune with it.
Interesting. It's nice to hear a non-biased view on that.
Well, maybe I'm biased, but not the same way as they are.
You don't have a vested interest in it.
No, I don't have a vested interest.
Claudio?
What was the other thing that we mentioned that we were going to add on that?
It was going to be future treatments. Remember that? Just the future of anything coming up that was new.
Oh, yeah. What are the latest things that have been approved?
Yeah, that's what I mean, the latest things being approved. Recently, two drugs have been approved. One which increases appetite in people with HIV, which is a big problem, because nutrition makes a hell of a difference. Okay, when people have a good diet, they do much better. Okay, but the problem is that very often people with HIV, especially if they are taking AZT, their appetite is really low and they are not, you know, feeding themselves well. So there's this new drug called Marinol, which is THC, the good old THC in a pill, you know, pot in a pill. That has been approved. Another drug that's been approved is called rifabutin, which is a drug to prevent MAI, this mycobacterium infection I was talking about, which is another good point. That's another. We have already like three or four of them that are good to prevent that. What else has been approved? That's about it recently. I mean, you know, we always think about AZT, DDI, DDC, these things like that. They are very sexy. They are very, you know. But for people with HIV, all the other obscure drugs to treat this infection, to clear, you know, this little skin problem, to increase appetite, to relieve fatigue, that's really what makes a difference for them. And, you know, these go through approval and everything, and we don't pay attention to, I mean, we do pay attention, but usually the media doesn't pay attention to those very much. And they hit his body for a few days because they didn't know what to do with it. And so his lover was running all over Las Vegas trying to find him when his body was hidden by these guys, and they have disappeared. We don't know where they are at this point. So the whole ozone thing is extremely, extremely suspicious. A lot of people are making a lot of money out of it. They are selling, you know, even powders that you can take, supposedly putting ozone in your body and things like that. And it's really, I mean, in my eyes, it's really bogus. The oxygen thing, on the opposite, has some potential for people who are really sick. It doesn't stop anything, but it seems to help relieve their symptoms and improve their quality of life, which is very important.
Now, so ozone, you said it was toxic?
Yeah,
I mean, was there some toxicity?
Well, the guy died. I mean, I guess it was toxic.
Isn't it? I mean, well, it's because what they probably gave him the wrong mixture. I mean, they probably did the overload the system with the ozone and caused a reaction that way?
I couldn't get to know exactly how they administer the ozone, but
it has to be medically.
Usually, yeah. Usually, what they do, they pull the blood out of the body, mix it with ozone, and push it back in the body. And if you're not professional to do that, you can't really have the blood, you know, coagulate more or less in the chamber, and back in the body, you inject, you know, poison basically. And I don't know what happened in that particular case, but that's what people used to do, and it's really toxic. I mean, you have to understand that there's a whole, you know, people are really looking into what destroys the immune system in HIV disease, and one of the things we found out is that so a few years ago, this physician in Orange County developed this drug, chemical called Viroxan, and when that was administering it to people, and a few people died after injection. So the family is starting, you know, sued the physician. He was arrested, and he was stripped from his license, and now he's somewhere either in Mexico or Kenya, one of the two, trying to push his thing still. But that was a case, and also a physician in the valley that was just administering it. I mean, some of his patients wanted the drug, so he got it from the guy in Orange County and administered it in his office. Also got his license removed for that, because it was really you know, from off the left field, really strange.
What did it do? What did this drug do? I mean,
it's. It was supposed to destroy the virus in the blood. However, there was, I mean, there was no, you know, no data behind it. It was just cooked on the kitchen counter and then administered to people.
Wow. Now, have you dealt with oxygen or ozone treatment?
I have a few clients here that went through that a few years ago. And ozone, I mean, oxygen therapies are a little different because you can do oxygen therapy through different ways. And right now there's a lot of interest in trying to increase the amount of oxygen in the blood of people to try to help them fight the disease and other infections. And they use hyperbaric chambers that are the chambers used for people who have the bands, where you can have people breathe a mixture which is rich in oxygen to bring more oxygen into their blood. Ozone is a whole different ballpark. My clients that were trying ozone had a lot of side effects, there was a lot of toxicity. They stopped doing it and they didn't see any effect. There was a study in Canada of ozone, they didn't see any effect either. But it's still going on after years and years and years, there are still people promoting ozone. And recently I have a client of mine who went to Las Vegas to receive an ozone treatment that was like $24,000, and he died during treatment.